Bye bye. Trippy fade out. Let you know it's time to start the Talk Like No One's Listening podcast. Episode 8, I believe. And it's been quite a while since the last episode. Maybe more than 2 weeks. I'm trying to do this at least once a week, trying to be consistent. But since the last episode till now, shit got crazy. Had lots of work, crazy work to do, and crazy personal life things going on too. Just life decides it wants to take you on that roller coaster real quick, and that's what happens. You run out of time, you get burnt out, you got no energy. Your daughter ends up waking up an hour earlier than she usually does. And yeah, there it goes. But here, we're back. So let's get started. This week is album review. Willow Smith, the first. Released October 31st, 2017. Halloween. Willoween. Whatever you want to call it. And so on this album, it was, for the most part, Willow and myself in the studio. I got to record just about everything, maybe 90% of everything I recorded, and 100% I mixed. So this was a very special project for me. I might even say this is probably the most special project I've ever worked on because of what I'll explain over the course of this podcast. I've been working with Willow maybe since the very first time I ever worked with her was maybe 6 years ago, I think. So she would have been 11. She would have been a tiny, wee little gal. And now she's almost an adult. And I've never experienced that before in my professional career, to work with somebody that long that they go from being a child to an adult. So it's very interesting over the years to see the many levels of growth. First is physically, and then artistically, creatively, mentally, you know, emotionally, intelligence, like just everything. Musicianship, songwriting, production, performance, just all of it. It's just a giant tree, watching a giant tree grow from a little sprout in the course of 6 years. So yeah, I hope by this time, if anybody is listening, as usual, I doubt that anybody is, which is why I titled the podcast what I did. One day, I hope everybody out there will prove me wrong and that plenty of people will be listening. But maybe once that happens, I'll be talking as if people are listening. But for now, I still feel comfortable enough to talk freely about whatever. So, what shall we talk about? Okay. Over the course of this album, from day one till day, whichever one was the last, Willow was learning how to play guitar. When we got to the point of recording some of the very first songs that would end up being on this album, she had probably only been maybe a few weeks into taking guitar lessons. So she was still just trying to figure out how to make hand shapes, to make the chords. She was still having pains on her fingertips from blisters and calluses and all that stuff. it was a challenge. But she decided she was going to not waste any time, and just as soon as she learned how to play any type of chord, she was writing a song with it. So if you listen to this album, it's not totally like chronological, but basically all the songs 1 through 9 were done about 6 months to a year ago. I mean, worked on and completed. And then the last two songs, A Reason and Romance, were done more recently, within a month or two of this album being released. So if you pay attention to the guitar playing, between the first 9 and the last 2, you can hear the progression of her guitar playing. And you hear it goes from more simplistic to more complex. And then you'll also hear, within the songwriting, you'll hear how that guitar playing made a difference in her songwriting as well. Which I think it's a great thing, that what this album is as a record. It's like a record of songs, but it's a record of somebody's life too. And yeah, I was really, by the time we got to the end of it, and I saw that, okay, this is what the album is now, because now it's time to mix. So, okay, we got it finalized as far as what is the track listing. Out of the many, many songs that got made, these are the 11 that made the final cut. But out of all of these, they ended up all being 100% live instrumentation, which is awesome. I spent the majority of my career working for clients that were in mainly the mainstream world. Pop, R&B, hip-hop, rap, urban, dance, electronic, whatnot, what have you. So every day I'm dealing with Logic, Ableton, Pro Tools. Everybody's giving me files, digital files. So when you do an album like that, or you do projects like that, songs like that, you can't really say you're the tracking engineer. I mean, you track the vocals, I guess, but you didn't track the music. You just imported the files. So for me, during most of my career, because that was the case, I always felt like I wasn't totally a legit engineer, because I didn't have a lot of experience recording live instruments. Like, I didn't feel like, oh yeah, I know what to do to record a drum set. I know how to get that drum sound. I know how to mic guitar amps and record strings and horns. Like, I didn't have that under my belt very well. So whenever I would see other engineers, either talk with them or see them talk in interviews or just work in other studios or just listen to other albums and be like, man, those guys are actually the real engineers. I'm cutting vocals in Pro Tools, which, I mean, to me is like mindless work. I'm just saying that, I mean, it's super easy. That's not much of a challenge in recording vocals, I feel like, compared to trying to get great recordings of, like, say, a drum set. That's much, much more involved. There are many more technical issues that you have to deal with, and also aesthetic issues, knowing what is going to be a good drum sound, because it's not like objective on paper. You could say, oh yeah, this is how you make a good drum sound. It's, you can only hear it when you hear it. You got to just go for it, try to do it, try to get your recording setup figured out, mics and mic pre's, any kind of processing, EQ, compression, whatever you're going to do. And then, you know, if it sounds good, it sounds good. No one could tell you one way or the other. Or some people can. But what I'm saying is, you know, compare that to just hitting record and someone's singing or rapping. And then it's like, all right, well, there it is. If you're not the mixing engineer, then it's kind of like, all right, well, you kind of just did your job. Or, you know, you did what you needed to do. So for me to be able to record all live instruments and mix all live instruments, it was a very pleasant challenge to do that. And I would say this album was, even though if you listen to most of the songs and it's very minimal instrumentation going on, is not, I don't know, on most of the songs is only a few elements, you might think, well, that's going to be a pretty easy mix. You only got like two or three instruments and then a vocal. Like, that should be pretty simple to mix. But once you get down to it, specifically for this, it was pretty much, these are probably the hardest mixes I've ever had to do. And part of that is because of specifically Willow and her voice and her style of singing and her style of, yeah, I mean, it's the singing, really. You listen to it. So basically what is going on when you hear these songs, she has such a wide range of what she can do. This is the widest I've ever experienced in any vocalist as far as the dynamic range, from the quietest thing she sings to the loudest things that she sings, and then the lowest note pitch-wise she can sing to the highest note, then character voicings as far as like singing as different characters. I mean, different, you know, tones in her voice. She can sing like five or six different types of voices. And what she'll do is mix up all those elements very frequently, almost to where in one line of one verse, she can go from both ends of the spectrum on all those areas I just mentioned, to where every couple of words is almost like as if it's a different person singing those two, three words. Then the next two, three words, it's a different person singing those words. And so on and so forth throughout the whole entire song and throughout the whole entire album, really. So the challenge becomes, mix-wise, is to get so much variation wrangled in to where it all sounds like it's all one thing. And each different voicing that you're hearing and each tone and each pitch range, I'm getting it to mix into the music as best as I can. Excuse me if I end up coughing a lot. I'm a little sick, trying to deal with this cough and trying to keep breathing, trying not to die. So what might typically happen with a vocalist that's not as high level as Willow is, you might hear, they might sing the song in basically the same voice and kind of stay within not too wide of a range of notes pitch-wise. So what you get is you can throw on a setting for your EQ, your compression, your reverb, and those kind of things. And you can kind of just set it. And for the most part, that's going to work for the whole entire song. And you can just make a few adjustments throughout here and there, automation-wise and things like that. But I can't do that. I couldn't do that in this case. I had like a very general bass kind of setting that I would do. But I really had to just do constant automation constantly. And it was a challenge because there also is very minimal instrumentation going on in the background, that everything is that much more exposed and naked, and it is what it is, and you're going to hear it for what it is. So everything has to be just on point, each individual element. Whereas if you have a mix that's like a full drum set, guitars, keys, strings, horns, bass, like lots of vocals, like just lots of elements going on, the more you add in, the more they help to mask each other. So where each individual thing does not have to shine so much, it just has to fit into the mix. And a lot of times, if it is a very dense mix, all the individual elements actually have to get diminished a little bit. Like you actually have to take away from them. You have to take away from the fullness, take away from their full frequency range. You got to cut out some frequencies a lot. You got to compress them a lot, to squeeze them down. Also that you can make room for that vocal to sit on top. And I think in that case, the mix gets easier. And for this album, for these songs, like I'm saying, it was the opposite end. So I had to make, okay, there's a guitar, there's a piano, and there's a vocal. That's it. So each thing, I can't really take away too much. Otherwise, it just sounds, it would sound thin and lacking in body and fullness and whatnot. And it was kind of nice that I was able to let everything be full frequency and just have full body to it. That's very different from what I'm usually doing and what I'm usually hearing. So everything about working on this was a very nice change of pace. And let's see. Yeah, so continuing on, just explaining mixing her vocal. I had to do a lot of automation. I had to do a lot of is a new type of plugin, new type of processor that wasn't around a few years ago. It's a dynamic EQ, where it's like an EQ and compressor hybrid, where you can pick a frequency like you would with an EQ, and then you can, on that frequency, with the curve and the Q and, how sharp or how wide you want it to dip or whatnot, it's compressing it with the threshold so that you're not taking away that frequency 100% of the time. You're just reducing it when it gets to a certain level. And I feel like that's been so helpful for this process. And it's now just become a staple for how I work and how I mix. Because I feel like you maintain a lot more of the fullness of the signal of whatever the track, whatever the element is that you're mixing on. That way you're not taking away frequencies when you don't have to. You're just keeping certain frequencies in check. So the voice doesn't get, when she's singing super low notes, it doesn't get too bassy and boomy. But then on the next few words, she'll switch to like a high-pitched wail, and then all of a sudden you're like, okay, now the high frequencies are just piercing, so I need to pull that down, or that needs to be pulled back a bit. But then, like I said, when it's in the middle or the low frequencies, you don't want to have those high frequencies taken away during those times, because then it's not going to be so clear and present. And also, as she's going from her quiet singing to her loud singing, it's such a huge difference. Like if you're in the room with her, hearing her sing, it was just, when she's doing her quiet singing, it's like somebody whispering in your ear. Like that's the volume. And then the loudest is just like straight, like savage roar. Like, I'm coming for you. I'm gonna kill you with my club. like battle cry, where it's like if you're standing next to her, you're gonna lose some hearing. So to like make that all work in the application of this song, to make such a huge difference in volume, and then just to reduce that gap, just to close the gap to where it's everything is more even, before you add anything like reverb or anything that's going to give you a sense of space, it's going to make it sound really weird. Because like you're going to know, like your brain is going to know that it should sound way louder and way quieter in certain parts depending on what the voice sounds like. So, but obviously you just can't do that for a song. You can't just have it be super quiet and super loud. It just wouldn't work. People need to be able to listen to music in their car, in their headphones or speakers or wherever, in the laptop, and not have to like constantly hit the volume up and down because the shit is getting like way too loud or way too quiet. That's, no one wants to do that. That's annoying. So you got to make it easy for the listener, but then you also have to make, you have to trick the mind into accepting this kind of thing that's a bit unnatural. And the way I did that, way I guess it works, is with the use of reverb and delay and space. So the quieter she gets, the less reverb I'm using. And the louder she gets, the more reverb I'm using. So this ties in with just, you know, mic technique for singers when they're performing. It's just when you see someone singing live, if they know their proper mic technique, then most of the time the mic's right there in front of their face. But then when they're belting, they're leaning back and their arm is pulling that mic away from them a bit. And that is for the same purpose of not destroying people's ears in a live performance when you're going to belt. So it makes sense that, okay, if somebody is, I can tell that they're singing super loud, but then the volume is about the same level as them singing quiet. When you add the reverb, it just tricks your mind into feeling as if she is physically moving away from you. She's taking like a few steps back from you. So naturally, you're going to hear more of the sound of the space in the room that she's in, which she's in a vocal booth with no sound. That's what, how we mind fuck you with reverb. But that's how it all works. And there's delay too. It gives you, you know, the echo, repeating echoes that help with just that extra dreamy fantasy world like thing that just makes it a little bit an unbelievable believing thing. You know, I don't know. It just helps with the suspension of disbelief. How about that? Okay. So challenge. That was the challenge. And then, you know, and then there's the challenge of like, okay, I'm not going to make everything exactly, you know, a straight line as far as volume. Some things should be heard slightly quieter and some things could be pushed to feel a little bit louder. So, you know, that was totally just up to me to decide in the moment of each section of what's being sung, what feels right. The music, you know, guitars, pianos, drums like that, those things were naturally kind of be closer to not have such a large dynamic range, unless like specifically that's what they're going for. But you know, pretty much like a song, someone's strumming chords to a song throughout the song, for the most part, that's usually going to be like pretty close to like one solid volume level. So that's like okay, that is what it is. And so what I was thinking though, because that's kind of the background music is kind of like that on some of these songs, that there has to be something else to create the movement, to create some type of variation, because a lot of songs there's no drums, and sometimes like no bass or nothing. It's just chords of a guitar and a piano or something. So usually those additional elements will help move the song along by creating these kind of peaks and valleys of volume when all the instruments come in and when some of them kind of come out and it kind of comes back down, it chills out, and then it comes back up. Say like for a chorus, everything's back in. So because we don't have that, there's not always like an indication that we're moving into a different section of the song or, you know, just on a timeline of how the story is moving. So I had to figure out just what I could do with her vocals. And that was the main thing. It had to happen a lot with the vocal of how I was going to create enough subtle variation in the vocal for volume, and then how I was playing with reverb and delay effects, bringing them up and down so that each moment is just feeling right. It's not throwing you off. It's feeling like what it should feel like based on what she's singing, what she's talking about, what's the mood, what's the emotion, what's the thought, things like that. And so I had a lot of fun being faced with this challenge because I had to think about a lot of stuff that I had never thought about before. So it really made me reevaluate myself as far as what I do engineering wise and my approach. And really I had to just not think like an engineer necessarily. I just had to feel the music. That's all. Feel it the best that I could so that it would, so that other people would feel it. That's the main thing. I wanted people to hear the songs and have zero thoughts about the engineering. Just make it invisible. Just make the songs as enjoyable as they can be. And just make the most enhanced version of what Willow had already done. And Willow and then all the other musicians that contributed to the album. And so, yeah, so there was a couple of collabs, a couple of other people working on this album as well. Dev Hines, he was a big contributor. Dev Hines, Blood Orange, Lightspeed Champion. Test Icicles, if you know from way, way back. Look that one up. I love that name, Test Icicles. When you listen to Boy, that's Dev playing the cello. Originally, the song was written with Willow playing that same pattern on her guitar. And that was just the first version of the song, what it was. And then Dev did his thing, brought his cello. Little did I know, he said cello is his first instrument. I think that's what he said. And I've said this in a maybe previous episode, probably talking about Tyler Cole's album, that, yeah, I was a big fan of Dev's music over the years. So to be able to work with him also in studio, in person, was a nice surprise. And it was actually a surprise because I didn't know. We were just in the studio and I just hear him talking about, oh, Dev's on his way. I'm like, oh, who's Dev? And he walks in and it's like, oh, Dev. Okay. So that's what's going on. All right. Let's not be weird. Let's not be a weird fanboy. Let's keep it to yourself. And, but hey, now I have a podcast and I can talk about this shit. Whatever I want. So that was cool. Boy did the cellos. He also did, he produced Oh No! Exclamation, exclamation, exclamation. Yeah, he did that one too. And then was there something else? I think he played piano on Israel. Yes. And Yeah, that's it. But that was cool. Yeah, those are nice little additions. Lonely Road, Chloe and Haley. They're awesome. I think that was a perfect collaboration between girls that are just they're super talented. A group of three girls that are all super talented musicians and just have really I think bright futures ahead of them with their music and what they're doing. They're just off to a good start. So the fact that they all got to be in the same room together, this wasn't like one of those, pop collaborations where a song's done and someone just sends an MP3 to somebody else and be like, hey, rap on this. And then they rap on it and then they send it back and two people never ever meet in real life. No, the song was written and recorded. All three of them got together in the same room and I had the pleasure of sitting and watching them create this whole thing from scratch. And it happened like really quickly. Really, really quickly. They're all just on point. They just know what they're doing. They just got in and they knocked it out. And yeah, I mean Willow, she always knocks it out like super quick. She's one of the fastest songwriters and just recording artists like I've ever worked with. I mean, probably in general, she's probably top three as far as just most talented, coolest people I've ever worked with. She always just comes in and it just amazes me how fast she can either come up with something on the spot if she has to, or if she already came in and the song's already written, how fast, she can record it and put it down. Like a lot of artists, it's like a shocking percent of artists out there that you listen to, if you actually got to see how many of them, like while they're in the studio, if you got to see how they actually are when they're working in the studio, it's like a large percent of them really actually struggle when it comes to vocals, like to get that final take, to get the right take that they feel is what they want it to be. And some people struggle just to actually get a good performance. A lot of people get nervous just from the fact that they're actually recording. So they feel like the pressure's on that they got to get it right. And then some people are actually really good singers and they can get it, but they just like nitpick forever. And they'll just want to re-record something over and over and over, like all day, because in their mind, oh, it's not good enough. So there's two different, things going on, but neither of those things is happening in this case for Willow. She's just like, she knows what she wants and she can pull it off and get it done quick. Super easy. Makes my job really, really easy on that aspect. let's see, who else? Anybody else? Anyone else? Anyone else? There's a couple of people I'm going to forget. So I'm not going to try to name everybody because I know I'm going to forget somebody. I don't want to forget. But anyways, those are a few examples of features on this album. But they all made these songs that much better. And it's nice to, yeah, just to be able to hear another musician's contribution, listen to their track, listen to what they did. Because a lot of times when it gets busy in the studio and we're just like recording, 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 people coming and going, and there's just a lot going on that I might not really be focused on what they were actually doing in the moment. So once I get to hear it in the mix and solo it and just have a moment with it, and then I go, oh, okay. Oh, that's what's going on. Okay. And then I can get that appreciation for what they're doing. All right. So, what might people want to know about this? I did it all in the box, I'll tell you that much. Which that's always a thing. That's a big thing, for engineers is like mixing with analog gear versus doing it in the box. And I've, for the most part, I've been leaning more like pro, like, yeah, you should use analog gear if you can, if you have it accessible to you. It's going to sound better. And whenever I've had the opportunity to do that, and then maybe on a different song of the same project, maybe I just don't have the same gear available to me. Maybe I was just at a studio and it wasn't my own gear. And then the next time around, I just got to do the next song just on my own, just at home on my computer. And then I compare them and I just can't really tell the difference. Like, it's like, maybe it's like a subconscious subtle difference because I know what I did to make it, but like really, it just doesn't sound so different. And I'm the engineer, I should know, right? I should be able to hear that difference. So I figure if I can't hear the difference, really, if it's not noticeable to me, then nobody out there is going to hear it. And, you know, it's all about knowing how to use what you have. You can have all the nicest analog gear in the world, and if you just don't know what you're doing, then that doesn't matter. It's not going to sound great. But if you have some basic plugins and you just know how to use Pro Tools, like I'm in the Matrix of Pro Tools. Then that works for me. And that's my technique. I mean, that's my approach, because that's what I have available for me at the moment. So that's what I use. And in a lot of ways, I've come to rely on certain techniques and processes that are really only available in the computer. There's a certain level of precision that you can achieve with computer that you can't just by doing it by ear. And a lot of people would just be like, it's all about just the ear. Well, yeah, of course. But if you can use tools to help you improve, enhance upon what you are hearing with your ears, then why not? You know, you could fly a plane if you have to just by looking at the window. But if you have good instruments on the dash, that's going to save your life. So, and it just makes things easier for me, because your ears are your ears. And yeah, I mostly rely on my ears and what I'm hearing, what I'm feeling, but there's other things going on besides what I can hear. You know, there's other things happening in the signal that have an effect on the end result of what's coming at the speakers. And I might not be able to hear it, but it's something is in there that's going on that if I can target it and figure it out and manipulate it in the computer with the tools that I have in the computer, like say a frequency spectrum on an EQ that allows me to see exactly what's going on in all these frequencies. It might be, yeah, something that I can't hear, but if I can find something that's just kind of peeking out a little too much of a certain frequency and I can pull it back, it's going to help the overall feel and blend of the mix, and the mix will sound better even though I couldn't hear that one thing that was going on in it. So I just feel like, do whatever you like, do whatever works for you. I used to feel a little bit like I wasn't like a legit mixing engineer because I didn't have mixing gear. But now, you know, I did this album on a laptop, an old laptop from 2010. I have not even using an interface. I literally am coming out of the aux straight to my cheap Yamaha speakers. They're like $200 a pair, and my $80 sub that I bought off of like eBay from like 10 years ago. And that's it. And I have a little office room at home. It's like not treated for sound at all. I just have a bunch of shit in here, which deadens the sound, which helps. And then that's how I mix. And then I listen to my headphones, in my headphones. And then I listen in my car. And then I'll, whenever I'm in another studio for a session, I'll take a listen there. And then so between all those different sources, of course, they all give you a different feel, but I can average out how it feels in all those different sources for monitoring. And I just try to find a nice middle ground. And that ends up being what I decide on as being the final finished mix. And yeah, I kind of now at this point, I feel good about myself that that's what I have to work with and I make it work. So if you're somebody listening to this right now and you want to get into engineering or you want to get into producing anything music wise and you just feel like, oh, if only I had this, if I had this one thing, if I had this piece of equipment, if I had this software, if I had this plugin, if I had this program, if I had this one instrument, it would be, I'd be set. No, you wouldn't be. If you can't be set now with what you have, well, that's not an absolute, but just maybe a rule of thumb. If you can't feel like comfortable with what you have, I mean, unless you have like a Casio keyboard from the 80s and you have a 4-track tape recorder and that's like, that's it. And you're trying to make like pop hits. Yeah. You're probably going to need to upgrade. But yeah, if you got a laptop, if you have a laptop, you're pretty much are okay. You know, even if you don't have a lot of money, there's of course ways around that. You know, I don't condone it, but you know, it happens. It's a reality. You can get stuff online. If you're crafty, you can get plugins, you can get sounds, you can get instruments, what you need. You can go to something like splice.com, which is like the best thing out there right now for producers, songwriters. Like, you just have a shit ton of sounds that are available to you, royalty free. They sound good and it's like super cheap. I'm not endorsing them at all. I'm not getting paid. But I use them. And I think I always tell people when they're trying to ask me, where can I get new sounds, get new instruments and things like that? I said, just I point them in that direction and leave me alone. Cause I used to be, when I was in the studio world and I was in there, I used to be that guy that had a collection of a whole bunch of stuff, sounds and plugins and effects and all that stuff. And I used to be that guy that would collect all that stuff and people would hit me up to get, you know, to get hooked up with stuff. And I did that for a while. And I never felt like good about it. I'm like, oh, you want to give me some money? I'm not admitting guilt to anything illegal right now. I'm just saying, I did that for a while and now I don't, because I just got to a point where I felt like, okay, just to play it safe, karma-wise, what if I stop doing that and I start paying for all the software that I use, or as much as I can afford to, as much as possible, pay for the stuff that I use? Maybe that will come back to me. And I won't feel guilty like I'm some kind of, you know, white collar criminal. And it could be coincidence, but, you know, things changed for me once I started thinking in that way. I got busier, work, you know, got busier, better projects came in more frequently, was making more money. So I would say, if you can, try to buy as much of the software that you use as you can. And if you can't, you know, some people just can't. And I was there once, you know, if you work at a studio, you are basically on welfare. So, you know, you're struggling to pay rent. So, of course, you're not going to pay for plugins. But if you stay in it long enough and you keep going, and you're making a living off of it, then it's time to be like, all right, enough is enough. I've met so many people that were like well off, and they still are using crack plugins and stuff. I thought, dude, just fucking buy it. What is wrong with you? Yeah. And I think a lot of plugin manufacturers, they kind of figured out, you know, that this was going on. They knew they couldn't do anything about it. So what's good now is a lot of companies, they offer subscriptions to their plugins, to where it's like, you know, month to month, short term, you're not spending a lot of money. But if you keep using their stuff for a few years, it actually, they're getting more of your money than if you would have just bought the plugin, you know, straight out in the beginning. Whatever. You know, whatever. It's affordable for people, and then the plugin companies make more money. If everyone's happy, fine. But anyways, it works. If you're on low income, low budget, there are options to where you can get good plugins to do your work. And if you have even just a part-time job, you should be able to pay for something. All right. I think I have not been talking about this album for quite some time. Maybe that's it, because, well, I don't know. Do I got any other interesting tidbits? Bits of tid. I had fun, a lot of fun, especially on Warm Honey and Human Leech, because those are the two songs that have drums on it. And the drummer was Keith Harris. If you look him up, he's a vet in the music world. He's a producer, songwriter, drummer. I'm sure he plays a bunch of other instruments too, but if you look him up, he's got tons of credits. He's been around for a while. So to be able to mix drums that were played by him, that was a nice little treat. And I mixed another song that had him drumming on it also before, that has not been released by another artist. And if that song gets released, that'll be my next episode. I'll talk about that song. But like, so to date, I've mixed three songs that had Keith Harris playing drums. And each time has been, it's been a lot of fun for me, because in each case, I had the freedom to do what I want mix-wise with the drums. And because it was just good source material, he's a good drummer, so I had that. And then the fact that I could just take it into a direction of my choosing was great. So starting off with Warm Honey, my lungs are playing tricks on me. Warm Honey. So initially, the drums, just as they're recorded, of course, they're just as recorded. They're not there yet. They need to be massaged and worked to sound like the record. So my approach was, I wanted the drums to be have some real denseness and body to them. I wanted the kick and snare to be heavy. And they weren't initially, of course, just as recorded. So I did a lot to make sure that the kick and snare would hit like it was a hip-hop song. Not like crazy in your face, but just, you know, just to be very substantial. And then I wanted also to have them feel a bit saturated, vintage-y, you know, sound like they were recorded to tape through analog gear, through a Neve console. Sound like just something you're hearing drums playing off of, like a 12-inch vinyl record. I referenced mixes from drums. If you listen to the drums off of like any Black Keys album, the drums off of the most recent Arctic Monkeys album, I think all mixed by Chad Blake, if I'm correct. But I really love how those drums sound, because they're rock drums, they're live drums, but they just have this extra character and edge and impact and punch to them that that kind of just gives it this hip-hop type of a feel as far as the impact and the punch. So I wanted to have those elements in the way these drums sounded. So it was a lot that I had to do. I did layers upon layers upon layers of processing. Like, I could break it down, but I honestly don't remember exactly what I did. I did a lot, though. But again, it's all in the box. I'm all using plugins. So if you're listening to that and you're thinking that it wasn't, I don't know. If you're thinking that sounds good, thank you. First of all, thank you if you enjoy anything about this album from the engineering side of things. I appreciate if that people, yeah, like the end result. I worked very hard to make it enjoyable. And then Human Leech. Human Leech, same drummer, same drum kit, but a completely different song, styling-wise. So I wanted to make sure Human Leech felt heavy. I wanted to feel like, I mean, I listen to rock, so I wanted to feel like legitimate, authentic rock. I didn't want to feel like people would hear this that aren't like Willow fans and be like, oh, this girl's trying to do a rock song. Like, trying to do. I don't want it to sound like she's trying to do anything. I just wanted to be like, oh, this is what it is. So, of course, you know, making guitars and the bass and all that heavy, I wanted to make sure that the drums were as impactful and aggressive as it could be, especially coming into the choruses when it's, you know, it's time to go all the way up to 10. So initially, though, what I was feeling was that the drums just weren't, the drums themselves, just for what they were not quite there. And I had to figure out what to do. You know, I was like, well, EQing it and all this stuff to beef it up, just, it's not quite beefy enough. So I just decided, let's get experimental and nobody's looking. So let me just try something out, and I'm not going to say anything. And I still probably haven't said it to this day. So anybody listening, this is the first time I'm saying this out loud. I took all the drums for Human Leech and I pitched them down. Might have been one or two semitones, but that's what I did. I just took the entire drum kit, all the individual recordings of each mic, and I pitched them down. And once I did that, I was like, oh, okay. There it is. That's what I needed to be. Because the thing was, the drum kit specifically that was used to record this, probably not a kit that's what people would use to record heavy rock music. It's something that's more geared towards, you know, urban, R&B, pop, funk, hip-hop, rap, whatever, you know. So it's not so, like, heavy and dense. So just in my head of just thinking back to, like, heavy rock music that I would listen to where the drums sound that way, I'm like, okay, let me just manipulate these drums to sound like as if it was a different kit. So once I did that, I was off to the races. I was ready to go, and then I could finish up with the mix and get it to sound like what you hear in the final. And then I did a lot of, for both songs, I borrowed a trick from Chad Blake, which was to add distortion, like guitar distortion, but on the drums, but it's blended in. I added it to the kick, snare, and then the overheads, you know, duplicated layers, put a heavy distorted effect on them and just subtly blend them in, so you just get this little extra texture and bite, little fuzz to the impact and the hit of the drums. And I pushed it that even more so for Human Leech. And then Yeah, so once you hear the chorus come in on Human Leech, and then it's just like the toms are going, you know. It really all comes together. It was a little bit too boomy and a little bit too dense, so I had to do a little bit of surgery to kind of pull it back where it needed to be. But in the end, I was happy with it. I was happy with the punch and the impact and the size and just, you know, feeling of it. And for her vocal, this is the only song where I did this, where I did the same thing to her vocal, where I just took a layer, I duplicated her lead vocal, put heavy distortion on it, and I just, that's just slightly tucked in there just to give a little extra bite to her vocal, just to match and complement what's going on with the music. Because she has such a, you know, usually in all the other songs, it's like a very pretty, pristine type of voice, but I just felt like I didn't match so much for Human Leech for the instrumentation. So I was like, okay, this is the one song where we can get a little dirty with it. But again, I made it subtle. So if you hear it, listen close, listen to it in headphones, and you'll really hear it. The song that I played at the top was A Reason, and that song is probably one of my favorites off the whole thing, and that's why I picked it. And it's one of my favorites because, like I said, the first 9 songs were done, you know, probably by the top of this year. Those songs were pretty much like done and ready to go. And then, so there's a lot of time in between. And then I got back in the studio with Willow, and she had progressed a lot after, you know, so many months of just continuously practicing guitar. And then she had just gotten a new acoustic guitar, steel string. So this was like going to be the first song that she ever used to record on it. And then, so she had the song already written, already prepared. So she just came in and just laid it down super quick. So for me, it was like, whoa, what the fuck? Damn. That's how you're playing guitar now? Wow. Okay. And then she sang her vocals on top of the guitar, and I'm like, wow, okay, that's where your songwriting's at. Wow. All right. So for me, it was like, it was a big surprise to just see, you know, after taking some time off to come back and be like, wow, this is like crazy that you're at this level now. I was thinking, oh, okay, this is going to be the sound of the next album. Like, this is where you're at now? Okay, cool. Next album. And then the song goes on this album. And then Romance was the most recent. Romance was probably recorded and mixed probably like, maybe like a month before this whole thing got released, because it was so recent. I didn't think that Romance would be on the album either, but she did it, and it was like another thing where like, wow, you just elevated even further. Because with Romance, she had just gotten another guitar, a custom-made nylon string classical guitar, and then I was like, oh damn, all right, now you elevated even more with your guitar playing, you know, classical styling, and then even more so with songwriting, with your, how you're singing, what you're singing about, you know, vocal arrangements, whatnot. And then, like last minute, it's like, oh, this song's going on the album. I was like, oh, I guess I should start mixing that one, because the album comes out like soon. Final notes. I'm very, very proud of this album for both what Willow's done and what I've done as a result of what she's done. Because really I was just like, well, this is, you know, what she's done is such a great body of work. I really want to give it my all, do the best job that I possibly can, do the best job that I've possibly like, or that I've ever done, which is what I was going for. And I feel like that's what I've done. I would say this is the best work I've ever done. If I was going to, you know, meet somebody new and they ask me what I do, and this, now I just point to this album and be like, okay, that's what I do, listen to it. And yeah, I was very excited that I had the opportunity to do this album, do almost all of the engineering, and then even now that I have a podcast and I get to talk about my work, I was very excited to talk about everything that went on in behind the scenes working on this album. So I hope any of you listening have heard the album. Hope you enjoy it. Hope you will check me out next time, next episode. There'll be more. Got more to talk about, but I don't know. It's time to go. So thank you. See you next time. Peace.